Hi everyone, welcome to day three of our winter squash week as part of the Winter Vegetable Sagra that is going virtual this year from December all the way through March. I'm really excited today to have Lisa with us. Hi Lisa.
Hi Lane.
Lisa's also here in Portland, Oregon where I am, and she's a pastry chef. I met Lisa from Charlene from Nana Cardoon, who is a huge barley fan. And she was like, you got to get Lisa. She's this wonderful pastry chef. She was working at the time at Paley's Place in Portland. She's so fantastic. We got to get her involved in the Variety Showcase, which is a big event, a Culinary Breeding Network event that was put on last year, actually almost a year ago in February of 2020, right before COVID hit. That same event is going to be a virtual event this year through this programming. So you guys will be able to learn more about plant breeders and what they're up to. And that is the week of February 22nd through the 28th. But last year, Lisa, you made really like one of the dishes that was the one that I would hear about over and over and over again, that I could never get to in the big crowded room, but it was so beautiful looking and so interesting. It was a pureed tetsu kubota squash in a barley cone. And you were at the table that actually focused on the squash, but we wanted to make sure that we put the barley in there as well. So you actually had two ingredients that were provided to you that you were working with, and you made something just absolutely fantastic. And so many people have said, like, how do we make this at home? So that's what you've done for us today. And you made a video about that, and that's what we'll watch today. And then we'll have people ask questions about that. So I really want to thank you for being here. And unfortunately, due to COVID, you're not working at Paley's A Place anymore, but you've got a lot of exciting things on the horizon. You're still doing some work in the culinary world, but through hunt and gather, doing some catering, as well as a new job with Do Good Multnomah, which is a nonprofit that provides housing to veterans, which is so fantastic. So you have so many different talents.
Go ahead.
I was gonna say, if there's anything that
I'm just so delighted that people really enjoyed the squash waffle last year. It was a surprisingly fun thing to make. So excited to share it with you all today.
Great. And for people listening, even the kids loved it. And I mean, sometimes it's hard to get kids to eat winter squash, but it looked absolutely beautiful and is super tasty too. So for everybody watching, please just chat your questions as they come up, and then we'll ask them to Lisa after we watch this. It's about 25 minutes long. And we'll find out how she created this beautiful dessert made with tetsu. See you back in 25 minutes.
I'm Lisa, and welcome to my kitchen. Today I'm going to share with you how to make the winter squash waffle cone, or the squaffle, as it was affectionately dubbed at Paley's Place. Now, the squaffle came into being as a result of the Variety Showcase last year, in which I was partnered with Dr. Alex Stone of OSU and the Tetsu Kubota. Now, tetsu was new to me at the time, as I'm sure it is new to many of you, but I can tell you I fell in love with this squash, like in love with this squash. I have baked professionally for more than 13 years, and I have never met a drier cooking or more beautifully textured or highly flavored squash. In preparation for this event, I also did a little additional experimentation. And I am pleased to tell you that not only does the tetsu make a gorgeous puree that can be used in a number of baked goods, savory or sweet, but that it ferments beautifully. I made a curried ginger squash that was just outstanding. It sautés beautifully and also is delicious raw. And on top of all of that, this squash was bred to be a long keeper, and so its flavor actually improves or it seemed to improve with time, and is beautiful, just as beautiful in February as it is at harvest time in October or November. So that means that when you see one or at your farmer's market, don't be afraid to grab it, or five, and you won't regret it. Let's begin. All right, let's begin by getting our squash roasted. Now, I wanted to show you the difference in these two squash. Now, these might have been harvested at slightly different times. This one is probably a little bit younger than this guy right over here with the orange striping. As the tetsu ages, it becomes this beautiful orangey color. So for today's cooking, we're going to go ahead and use our slightly more ripened squash. I do not wash any of my squash until I am ready to cook them, so we'll give this guy a little bath and be right back. I'm sure many of you have roasted squash before, and so it's a very easy and simple process. I'm just going to cut our squash in half by cutting downward on one side and then turn it around and do the same thing on the other. It's a little safer this way than trying to cut around your squash and have your knife angled upwards at an angle in which you could hurt yourself. And then pop this guy open. Look at that, isn't that gorgeous? Just so pretty. And then you can snap off the stem. This can go straight into the compost. And I have a sheet pan here lined with some parchment. And we'll just put these both cut side down on our sheet pan and pop this into a preheated oven. I like to cook my squash at a fairly high temperature to get a beautiful char on the outside of the skin here. It's going to lend a little bit of a smokiness to the flesh of the squash. You'll want to cook, it's going to depend on your oven, specifically how long it will take, but until the skin is kind of charred and you can smell like a very pungent squash smell and everything is very tender. While our squash is in the oven getting all nice and roasted, we can start on our barley waffle cone batter and cooking. So we're gonna start by adding all of our dry ingredients into a bowl. We have our flour, half a cup of sugar, a little pinch of salt, and barley flour. Now the barley flour I use is from Tuolumne Plains Great Grains. It is grown by Lyle Spiesert out in Forest Grove. And I love all of the grains that Lyle grows. They are super flavorful and delicious. And this is of the purple karma barley varietal. And that's gonna go right on into our dry ingredients as well. Now, if you wanna experiment with adding whole grains to a recipe that you already have, a good rule of thumb is to not start with more than 30% of your flour. I'm just gonna give these guys a little mix here. And then we will start by adding in our egg whites. And I've added the vanilla to the egg white. Give that a little stir. And then after this is mixed, we will add our melted butter. This is very similar to a classic French tuile paste recipe in terms of method and ingredients. Okay, that's good. We'll add our butter. Oops. Now the waffle cones will keep fresh for several days in an airtight container. So don't be afraid to break this whole process up into different dates or different times. Particularly, it's not a particularly complicated recipe or method, but it is one that is going to require a little bit of time, both with the roasting of the squash as well as pureeing it and then chilling it down, which we will get to in a little bit. All right. Here we are. We have a nice homogeneous batter. Beautiful. Now, if you wanted to let this rest for a while, you certainly could pop it in the fridge for a bit. Just let it come back up to temperature before going ahead and working with your waffle cone press. I have a handy little scoop here, but if you just have a couple teaspoons, tablespoons, that's totally fine as well. You'll just want to cook your waffle cone batter according to the instructions on your own waffle cone press. Ooh, can hear that sizzle. Amazing. And the larger the scoop, the larger your waffle cone is going to be. So just keep that in mind. If you'd like something a little smaller, use something a little bit more petite. If you do not have a waffle cone batter, or waffle cone maker, excuse me, we are going to try a little experiment right now, right here. See if this works on just doing this in the oven, since it is very similar to a tuile paste batter. Tuile cookies traditionally are cooked in the oven, so we'll give this a little bit of a go as well. You want to add a fair amount on a spatula and then spread as evenly as you can on your Silpat. Parchment might work, but the moisture from the batter likely is going to cause some rippling effect. Let's go ahead and check our waffle cone here, see how we're doing. Oh, use just a moment longer. Our ready light has come up, but we're not quite there yet. This may take a little bit of trial and error, kind of like the first pancake, right? All right. So while we're waiting on our waffle cone, we'll go back to our little tuile batter experiment here. Nice, even, and around. Nor do you need to make this into an actual cone shape with the tuile. If you wanted to make this more into a little cup, you certainly could do that as well. Okay. Waffle cone cup. Ooh, now that is beautiful. Okay. I'm going to just use a heat-safe little spatula to help me get this up off of our waffle cone press. And if you have a mold that came with your waffle cone maker, awesome. If not, you can also just gently sort of pinch the bottom here and roll as you go. Now it's going to be very hot, so do be cautious of your fingers. And as it cools, it will set into place. Beautiful little waffle cone. How delicious is that? Now, for the garnish that was on the squaffle at the Variety Showcase, I did a popped purple karma barley that was then candied and caramelized. Do not feel like you have to make this at home. This is going to be a little bit on the more challenging side because we're going to be popping a grain in oil and then doing a candied version of that. Now, equally delicious would be a candied nut or a toasted nut or a like just shaved chocolate would all be equally delicious. But I wanted to show you all this method in case you're feeling particularly adventurous. So we're gonna start with the
a little bit of the barley and some ripping hot oil. This is not a technical term, but you can see that the oil has already started to discolor a little in the pan. You've got a lot of movement going on. The barley requires a higher temperature than, say, a popcorn when it's popping. Actually, this feels like this might be a little too much. Let's start right here, okay? And we're just gonna gently dip this into the oil and it's gonna start cooking, as you can see. And there we go. It's honestly deeply satisfying. All right, as these pop, we're gonna go ahead and scoop them out and onto a paper towel that is ready and waiting for us. I'm gonna go ahead and do several rounds of this. Now, not every single little groat or grain of barley is going to pop. To make sure that things are good and easy on our dental work, I like to go back through and make sure that I'm pulling out any of the unpopped grain. I just wanted to jump back on real quick and show a slightly different, not method, but a tool that might actually work a little bit better. So I have a tiny little sieve, and that way I'm not fishing around for any of my barley and having it become burnt. Much faster, much easier, but as you can tell, like, my oil is starting to smoke a little bit. I've turned it down. It's a little too hot. So just kind of keep playing and adjusting with whatever works for you at home. But I did try doing barley in an air popper, because I have one of those from the 80s, what I grew up with, and that wasn't quite hot enough to be able to turn these kernels inside out. All right, and we're back to our caramelized popped barley adventure. Okay, adventures in technology, take two. Apparently my phone does not like being too close to the heat source here. But I have my popped barley that I was going to use, as well as some ground malted barley. Malted barley is gonna add a little extra like sweetness and nuttiness, as well as some black pepper. In our pan over here, it had water as well as some sugar. When I'm candying nuts or even grains, I don't actually measure my amount of sugar. I know that can, once you get the hang of it, it'll be easy enough, but I know sometimes it's easier if we have specific quantities, but unfortunately we do not. The one thing candying or caramelizing grains is you want to cook out all of the water. When you're doing nuts, usually you want to have more of a simple syrup like consistency going on when you add your nuts into your sugar consistency. The water in a simple syrup would just basically melt all this work that we just did with our popped grains. So right now you can see, I think you can see in here, yeah. It's pretty much just down to sugar, not a lot of moisture in our pot right now. So I'm going to add in my little grain malted mixture. Hopefully you can see, until I have enough grains that are just coated, and maybe there's just a little bit of sugar in the bottom of the pan. But we don't want to have a lot of extra liquid. But we also want all of our grains to be evenly coated. So I might not even, I'll add just a little bit more, but I'm not going to use all of my grains that I have popped here. And now we just stir. When you are candying nuts or grains, the sugars in your pot are going to become crystallized. And you just keep stirring. You can already start to see there's a little bit of white forming. That's the sugar molecules crystallizing on our grains. And as you keep stirring over heat, those crystallized sugar grains are going to melt back down into caramel. I don't know if you can tell, but we're starting to pick up some color, and our sugar crystals have started to melt out again, We're gonna keep stirring. The deeper the color in a caramel, the less sweet it's going to taste. So I like to go to a pretty deep amber color. When you're doing any of these kind of caramelized grains or nuts, basically the name of the game is just keep stirring. Very much like Dorian finding Nemo. Just keep stirring. As soon as I get them to the color that I like, I will pour them out onto a silpat that I have right next to me here and separate the grains using a spatula and give them a little bit of seasoning. Do not touch the grains or nuts if you're doing nuts. Right away, as soon as they come out of the pot, they're going to be blisteringly hot. You will burn your fingers. So do exercise extreme caution. Wear gloves or use a spatula to separate any of your grains or nuts into little beautiful clusters, or wait until they're completely cool, and you can also pulse them if you're using nuts, pulse them in a blender for a kind of praline. That's the word I was looking for, praline. All right, now we are getting pretty close here to what I would like. You can see there's just a little bit of sugar in the bottom that is kind of a deep caramel color, amber. All right, so my squash is out of the oven and I've allowed it to cool a bit just so it's nice and easy to handle. You can see that the top here is pretty dark and fairly charred. There's a little bit of sugars that have released from the squash, but really not a lot if you say in comparison to like a Hubbard squash. So I'm just gonna go ahead and turn this over and scoop out our kind of our guts, our little bit of seeds here, and I'm going to do our flesh into a Vitamix or a food processor, whichever you have. Both work just fine. I do like to season my squash purees with a little bit of salt and lemon juice to taste, but I like to do so at the temperature at which I'm going to be eating the finished product. So if it is going to be a warm dish, I will season it warm. If it's going to be a cold dish, I will season it cold, because depending upon temperature, our palate registers things differently. Well, now we have our waffle cones. Both are ones made in our waffle press, as well as our little tuil versions, all ready to go. We have our beautiful garnish, and we have our chilled squash puree, and a little bit of melted chocolate to make our filling for our waffle cones. We're gonna just add brown sugar and cream to our puree. Super simple, added together, whisked together, and it's going to come out very similar to like almost like a soft serve or a pastry cream consistency. Just super delicious. So let's add our sugar first and kind of give that a good stir. And then I'll, because my bowl's maybe a little small for what we're doing, I'll add like a little bit at a time, kind of in a little, maybe if I can hold a stream, just to make sure I'm not sloshing it all over the place. See, it's lightening up in color a little bit. Almost like a custard, but without any of the egg. And look at that, nice and stiff, super quick, super easy, and super delicious. So we'll set this aside for just a moment while we finish up our waffle cones. Now, this is a step you certainly do not have to take, but I do think that it is pretty darn tasty myself, especially if you have a chocolate that has a little bit of acid to it. For the variety showcase, I believe that I used a Manjari chocolate from Valrhona, which has a very lovely floral acidity to it. But you certainly do not need to use that particular type of chocolate. And if you're not into tempering chocolate either, melting a few chocolate chips would also work just fine. Okay, all I'm doing is dipping our chocolate or our waffle cone into our chocolate, and we'll let it set for just a bit. Same thing with our little tweel cone guy. Oh my gosh, looks super delicious. And if you don't have a cone holder, like I do not have a cone holder, I have just used additional barley in a bowl so that we can hold up our waffle cone and make it very nice and easy to pipe or to handle. A little extra set of hands. Last one. Ah, delicious. Okay, set aside our chocolate and fill our piping bag. If you are uncomfortable having your piping bag over your hand like so, you can also use a glass and fit your piping bag over the glass. So if you don't have a piping bag, you could use a Ziploc bag or a piping cone made out of parchment, or even just a little spoon to dollop in. Very much into using whatever we've got, right? Especially now in these times. And then just go ahead and fill your bag or use your spoon. Woo! A little softer than I was expecting there. And then I'm just gonna start in the middle here and pipe all the way up. Delicious. And then top with a little bit of our garnish, or if you use nuts, or this could be, if you don't want to melt chocolate, this could be a really great opportunity to just shave a little bit of your chocolate over the top of your waffle cone or tart shell or whatever exciting little thing that you made at your house. Et voila! Thanks so much for joining me in our little squash waffle tutorial. Hope you enjoy. Bye-bye now.
That was awesome. Now I'm regretting again that I didn't get to taste it at the variety
show. Now you can make it at home.
Yes. I think that people are really excited about it, and you have some people that are going to definitely try to make this. I had a question that was, no questions so far have come up. I think you did a really great job of like explaining all of it. Someone said it was a great alternative to ice cream, which is definitely true. I was wondering what other things you would suggest, like if people didn't make the cone or the alternative that you suggested, like what would you just do with like the filling if you wanted to do that? You know, like, is there anything that you would suggest people putting it on?
I'm not sure just on by itself, but I think it would make a really great pie filling as an alternate to a baked pumpkin pie come Thanksgiving time. If you blind baked a pie shell or a tart shell of any kind, you could certainly add that in as a filling and maybe even add a little bit of cream on top, kind of more like, say a chocolate cream pie, but with a tetsu cream pie instead.
Yeah.
The puree on its own has such a wonderful flavor. Anything that you would use a squash puree in, it's going to be wonderful. So if you want to make a pumpkin bread, or I also have made little pumpkin pancakes before that are just phenomenal. They have like very beautiful custardy like texture, but are very on the more savory side of the spectrum. And also make a really great pumpkin butter as well. But actually, even if you wanted to add in the brown sugar and the cream, you could maybe make your own pancakes as well. It could be a really great filler for a pancake or a crepe. Mm-hmm.
No, that's great. And just for you guys listening, Lisa's going to give us the recipe. And so when this is posted to you, it will post to YouTube before I have the recipe on there. But as soon as I get the recipe from Lisa, I'll put it underneath the video. So you can follow the directions there too and know what, you know, what amounts to use for everything. Speaking of like the cake, there is, if you guys go to eatwintervegetables.com, there is in the recipe section a Tetsu Kubota snacking cake recipe there that Emily Squadra made. You can check that out. There's also in the video section of that website, there's a video about like different ways to use Tetsu Kubota that are not, I don't think there's any dessert ways, but there's some savory ways to use it. And then there's also the Eat Winter Squash website that you can find a lot of different squash recipes. And one thing I was thinking of, is I know that for a lot of people, it's like, sometimes it's like too much squash. So, I mean, you could roast it like you were showing. And I really liked how you roasted it like completely, like to death. So that, yeah. You know, and that it gets really nice and caramelized and smoky. But then using what you need, like this is what I do. I use what I need for whatever I'm making. If I'm making a pie or something, and then just freeze the rest and just stick it in the freezer. And because I have a child who doesn't really like winter squash very much, I like kind of try to hide it in a lot of things, like put it into like muffins and, you know, other baked goods but I mean, you know, at the same time, he loved this thing that you made and he loves the snacking cake. So I feel like in dessert kind of applications, it's kind of easy to sneak it in there. Someone said, could you bake with the flesh open so it could roast in a more concentrated way? So you put it down, cut side down. What if you did it up? Would it make a difference?
Potentially. It's already such a dry cooking squash. My slight concern would be that you would get more of a skin on the cut side of it, but if you're fine with just removing that skin, after you take it out of the oven, I don't see why it wouldn't work just fine. I often do things cut side down so that any excess moisture can and does leak out onto the pan. So it's maybe a slightly messier process, but for me in most baking applications, I want the driest puree or driest flesh that I possibly can. And with other types of winter squash, say like a Hubbard or even like a Kambogia, often then I have to put it in a cheesecloth and strain it. So I'm getting that excess liquid out. Whereas with the Tetsu, I don't have to. And yes, I also will freeze excess or extra roasted flesh, roasted material. But one of the nice things I think about Tetsu is that it is a much smaller size. So you can really adjust how much that you actually would like, you know, cooking one squash versus cooking four squash. Mm-hmm. Obviously, if you want to put a puree in the freezer, do it all at once, one time. Make a mess in your kitchen only once, do your dishes only once. But if you do want to kind of mitigate how much you're using, and because it keeps so well, you could just do one at a time.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
Yeah.
And then for other applications, like, we talked about this a little bit before this, but it's like, have you had much time to work with Tetsu in different applications other than desserts? Like, what would you maybe suggest just in like your, you know, knowing it's a dry squash and knowing what the flavor is, what kind of applications do you feel like you would use it in?
Yeah, so I haven't done so much quite this winter, but last year when I was first introduced to it, I did do a little bit of playing because my thought for myself was, well, I'd like to branch out. I'm a pastry chef. but working with a savory product, maybe I should try something savory. And so I did try fermenting. It is very dry, so you do need to have a brine, but it holds texture very well in fermenting. And then also it kept its flavor, which surprised me. And it also sautés really well on the sweet side, but you certainly couldn't mint any sugars. I did a little, it was like a garnish for some pumpkin beignets that I had made. And I just diced the squash when it was raw and then sautéed in butter, added a little sugar and added pomegranate juice as it was cooking and deglazing, and then tossed that with pomegranate seeds. And so it's like you have that really beautiful earthiness coming from the squash, but a little bit of a pop and acidity coming from the pomegranates. And I think that's a really beautiful combination and flavor profile together. Mm-hmm. And you can certainly keep that on the more savory side as a side dish, or toss with pasta potentially as like a nice filling.
Yeah, that would be great. I definitely tried it in a lot of different ways because we've had, you know, other chefs that have worked with us and, you know, try to come up with recipes and everything. But I feel like I kind of, you know, I'm really interested in hearing new ways because I feel like one thing, well, there's a few different reasons I feel like that people like kind of steer away from squash. And one is like cutting it. And that's like, it's scary for people. That's why we do like the squash butchery thing. And there is a video on the Eat Winter Vegetables and I think Eat Winter Squash where you can see like how Tim shows to properly like cut up winter squash so it's less scary. And of course, having like a good knife is very important as well, a good sharp knife. Especially with the tetsu, I mean, it means iron helmet, right? So it's really hard. But I noticed in your video that it was like super easy for you to like cut through it because it was a good knife probably.
And last year what I noticed, because I had quite a variety of ripeness accessible to me, that the riper gut, the softer it is. And even if it is called iron helmet, for me, it did not feel like a very thick skin squash or terribly difficult to cut, especially as it ages. Particularly in comparison to like some of the very large squashes where you almost need like a mallet to get into them. And some of the extra that I had from this cooking tutorial, I made a little salad for myself and I was able to peel the squash with just a peeler as well. So that skin really is pretty soft. It's not something that I would necessarily eat. Mm-hmm. Like a delicata, it's not quite that level, but it's certainly, for me, it wasn't terribly difficult to process that skin.
Yeah, you know, I kind of default to making caponata with it, which is like a Sicilian dish that's typically done with eggplant. And it's like got a agrodolce thing. So it's like a sweet and sour, and it's got capers and olives in it and celery and red onion. And so it's, you could just look up a caponata recipe and just use the squash instead. And I did it with tetsu. I've done it with lots of different squash, but it was really nice with the tetsu. And yeah, I cut it into like wedges and I started like cutting off the rind, but then I was cutting off too much of the, cause it is really thin. Again, I just use a vegetable peeler and it came off very easily.
Exactly. That's exactly what I did as well.
Yeah. Yeah. But I'm always loving like people like using squash and because I think that a lot of times people like cut open squash, put it in the oven 350 and then just bake it until it turns to mush, you know, which is great to like start with like a dessert, but just like to be eating squash as like squash and just, I don't know, I don't like that texture that much. I'm just like having like this mush that is like a baby that you're eating. So I'm always looking for different recipes. I'm also wondering, did you notice that there was any, like a lot of difference, or what was the difference between the squash that was younger and older? Did you feel like it was, you know, as it's aging and as we can tell with the different color that tetsu changes color, like just like black futsu, which is also very nice because that consumers can actually know when it's ripe, because that's one big problem with winter squash, because a lot of times in the markets, especially in grocery stores, you get squash that are not actually ripe and not ready to eat yet. And so they need some more time to sit. But so these are nice because then you can tell when they're getting riper, but it's good still at the, you know, this, when the rind or the skin is still green. And then as it turns orange, but was there any differences that you felt like in texture and flavor in the younger ones versus the older ones?
Right. So texturally, for sure, they definitely get a little bit softer and are much easier to cut the riper they are. Mm-hmm. And in terms of flavor, I would call it maybe a little bit more nuanced. The younger it is, it's maybe a little bit more single dimensional and maybe has a little bit more of an earthy note to it versus kind of being a little bit more complex, sweeter, nuttier. Yeah, so it's, I would call it a subtle difference. I wouldn't say, oh, don't, you know, don't have a squash that's a little underripe, it's going to be terrible. Mm-hmm. They're both fine. But yeah, if you have a more sensitive palate or really interested in how those flavors develop over time, I think it's a very interesting comparison. And especially if you can have one that's a little less ripe and one that's a little more ripe, mm-hmm. Side by side to kind of taste that difference, it's very interesting. And another thing that was interesting for me was tasting the squash raw. It's something I've become a little bit more and more interested in. And I've always been so surprised how much more like a melon they taste when they're raw. Now the texture, especially at the tetsu, is a little firm for a raw application. Like, so maybe allowing it to marinate in something or maybe like steam would be really great for a salad just to improve the texture a little bit. But it has this very delicate, almost cantaloupe-like flavor to it that I just think is really astounding that it can be so different from one to the other. Like, you have this very nutty, sweet, earthy, smoky, if you roast it really hard, flavor, or this very summer-like flavor in the middle of winter, just as you cut it raw. It's astounding.
Yeah, you know, Alex talked a little bit about this yesterday where we had created this squash flavor wheel. And to be able to do that, we convene a lot of people that are actually professional chefs and winemakers and coffee roasters that can really describe flavors very well, you know, pretty well. And we tasted the squash raw, and then we also tasted them pureed, steamed then pureed. And we didn't do the roasted because that just brings in too much like caramelly kind of flavor. So we just did the steam. So we would just taste, you know, the squash, like steamed it and pureed it. It was really interesting, like, to have both of these because the flavors were so different. Like you're saying, like these other ones, someone actually was like talking about watermelon rind, and it was so nice because there was like a brightness to it that reminded you not of winter, like you're saying, but like the summer. And it was like, oh, this is something nice that you could eat in this way that would kind of bring like some brightness into our winter lives, you know? Mm-hmm. And Alex was talking yesterday about tetsu and like how we, you know, for all the squash, how we look at like how flavor and texture, you know, measuring it without tasting it. They do like bricks and dry matter tests. And for tetsu, it really, the ratings are for both of those are very good, even as it ages, which a lot of times you get more sweetness, but like you get like really terrible, like the dry matter changes and you get like really mealy squash. And that's not something that I've experienced with tetsu at all.
No, me either. It has a very, very fine grain to it before and after cooking. And some squash can be a little bit on the stringy side. And even though, as I was scooping things out, it kind of looked a little stringy, but on the palate, it doesn't register as that. It has very smooth texture throughout, before and after roasting or cooking.
Someone is asking from Hawaii, like, what are your favorite varieties of the Machada squash?
With the Machada squash.
Is like the there's three main like species: the Maxima, the Machada, and the why am I blanking? And the pepo, sorry, the pepo, which is pepo is like what the summer squash are in, as well as like acorn squash and delicatas. And this is an interspecific squash, like cross of two different species. So it's an unusual one. It's a maximum cross with a machada. Also a machada is a butternut squash, black futsu. I'm going to answer for what we've seen, what chefs are really liking. That is actually, Tim Wastel says that is his favorite squash, and he does use it quite a bit raw. If you go to those websites I mentioned, Eat Winter Squash and Eat Winter Vegetables, both of them, you can find a recipe that he makes, a radicchio and black futsu, like shaved black futsu, just with like a vegetable peeler, squash salad with like an anchovy dressing that people freak out about every time he makes. And so that one is his favorite. But to just say a little bit more about, you'll learn a lot more about machadas tomorrow, because tomorrow we have a panel that will be coming from, we have researchers in Hawaii and Puerto Rico, and we have Commonwealth Seed also that will be talking about machada squash and other tropical squash. So there'll be more about that tomorrow that I hope that you can watch, because that seems like it's going to be very interesting. I think they have an hour of presentations tomorrow about machadas. Okay. Yeah, what are some of your other squash though, just in general, like if it's just by their common names that you maybe like? You know, one we talked about yesterday, that's a pepo. It's hard to know what species they are, you know, but there's one called Winter Luxury that someone brought up yesterday, which is a pepo. Those don't typically, I mean, do not store as well. I have seen some breeding work where we have seen a few different types that have been really selected for good storage, and we've seen a lot better storage, but they typically are, you know, very quickly after harvest, they can be consumed and they taste the best, like very early on, because they don't age well. But Winter Luxury is one that I know that a lot of folks like to use in, like, you know, pies. Like if, you know, thinking about that, like a pumpkin pie, like do you have a specific squash that you like to use for that?
Okay. Well, prior to Tetsu, I would say very frequently in the restaurants we'd use like a red curry squash or some sort of kombucha varietal. Again, just because of their drier qualities, it saves us a step in like the processing process. I did use some futsu last year, and for me, like as a baker, I wasn't quite as fond of them just because they're so deeply ridged. It was a little harder to process, especially if people like to use it as a puree. But I know that on the savory side of things, that the cooks actually just cut them along those ridges and then seared them, and they were beautiful in that manner. So on a savory side, I think the futsu was really, really lovely and really delicious. But as a baker, so frequently using more of the purees, something that is easily dissectable and very dry cooking is kind of on the higher end of the spectrum of what I like to use.
Great. Someone is asking about candied tetsu rind, and is that a thing? And I wonder if you have any experience with candying winter squash. And we are going to have a presentation by Spring, who has a farm in near Bend called Sakuri, who is going to talk about the traditional way of Native American way of drying winter squash with a really large squash referred to as gete. I think that I haven't researched this yet because it's not happening for a couple of weeks, so I might not have this actually correct, but it looks a lot like a Georgia candy roaster, a very long squash that she uses for canding winter squash. Is there anything that you have done in this realm?
I haven't, but I'll be very excited to watch and learn, something new in the repertoire.
Great. I think that is all the questions. People were asking about carb count, and someone looked it up. Okay. There are always people talk about like paleo, when we talking about squash. I think because there's like a, And I don't know much about this either. There's a movement with like, especially spaghetti squash, which is very low in sugar, and folks like to use it with their following like a paleo diet. So.
Yeah, no knowledge on paleo diet for this particular squash.
Well, I hope that people, I really hope that people go out and make this, and I hope that they kind of like tag you, and you can tag Culinary Breeding Network in it so we can see like what your cones look like. We'll see if I ever one day get around to making it. I would love to. But I really thank you for sharing all of this with us. I look forward to getting the recipe and sharing it with everyone. And it's really been an inspiration about how to use squash in like a really different way.
Well, thank you. It was so much fun.
Yeah. Okay, great. And hope to see everybody tomorrow when we talk about tropical squash, same time, same place. And then on Friday, you have to join live if you want to watch Fridays, because it will not be recorded. And it is about how cucurbits have changed over time by looking at old pieces of art like this. There's no winter squash in that one, but it's the type of paintings that Alice will be talking about and how we can tell how species have changed over time. Okay, thanks everyone for joining. Thank you so